Hey everybody, it's Jennifer with the Rustville Chronicles, and we are here on the last day of Inkcarceration Festival, but it is the best day for us because I'm sitting next to John Connolly from Sevendusts, and we're just ecstatic to meet him and to be able to talk to him. So, welcome. Have you ever played at a prison before?
We've never played at a prison in the United States. We did one in Australia once.
Was it an active prison, or was it an old, kind of like this,
but I don't know if it had the history of something like this.
Shawshank
is kind of one of those movies that no matter where it is in the movie, if it's on, we watch it from there to the end, like every time. So it's kind of cool being here. I keep looking over there going,
yeah, it's just like it is in the movie. So you guys have been really busy and just kind of rolled in this morning, kind of an active schedule of festivals and whatnot you've been putting up.
Yeah, I mean, we're only out for a week this month, but we did Summerfest last weekend and Rock USA, Rock Fest, and now here. So it's just been a really, really busy week. We had a couple headline shows in the middle, but we're going to be off for a little bit before we start up on the Plectron in September. But once we get going in September, we're kind of real busy.
So I was going to ask you about that because I heard that you are an active person outside of music and that you're training for a triathlon.
Yes, I am. I'm not regretting it at this point, but it's the first month, so everything is painful in areas I never knew I could be painful. But yeah, I mean, it was kind of one of those things that a buddy of mine's done. He's done a couple half Ironmans, and he was kind of looking at my running distances because I don't know why, but I got back in the habit of loving to run. I mean, it's not easy, but I just love the challenge of it. So I'm going to follow his lead, and he's going to kind of walk me through my first one. But we figured he did his first one with about a month's worth of training, and he said just finishing the race was a challenge for him. So we had a good game plan. We started about 10 or 11 months out. So I want to challenge myself not only to be able to finish it, but to finish it, obviously, as best. It'll be my best time ever. It'll be the only one I've ever done.
Is it an Ironman?
Yeah, it'll be a half Ironman.
Yeah, 7.3.
I take a couple steps back. I'm actually probably going to do a sprint or two before I get there just to work on transitions and things that I'm just not. I mean, it's one thing to get in the pool and hammer out laps or go run a 10K, and I can do that all day long. But it's those other things, the weird things, starting to run and you're like, I'm still wearing my helmet, what am I doing? Stuff like that. So I'll do a couple sprints before we get there. But yeah, I mean, I figured it's. I've always been into working out, training and stuff, but it was something that was completely, like, I'm in the deep end of the pool. I'm not a good swimmer. I'm not really a good bicyclist at all. I'm a decent runner at best, so I figured, all right, why not challenge myself and see what's possible.
And then, I'm amazed that you can do that, because I know, like, being here a couple days, I'm dehydrated, I'm tired. I'm exhausted. How do you fit your training into touring?
You just got to kind of stay with the program. I mean, the good thing about when you set up for these kind of things, I haven't started working with a coach, but my buddy who has worked with a coach, he's got like space and off-season things that I should be doing. Most of it's just getting time on the bike, time on the road, time on the swim. Just kind of the more you do any of it, the easier it's going to get. I mean, like I said, I'm still my first real month into just specifically training for this, and it's just time, just being efficient with the time. I mean, I would typically spend anywhere from an hour and a half to 2 hours in the gym if I was just fiddling around, doing lifting and stuff like that. Now I just have to dedicate the time and the swim around the bike, and then the weight training all kind of falls in around that.
I have one suggestion for you, if you have a couple mosh pits, you can put that first leg into the water.
That's why I think the swim is probably going to be my weakest discipline, so I'm going to be that guy just back there like this, going, alright, I'm going to doggy paddle for a while, side stroke for a while. I just figure if I get out of the water in decent shape, you know, it really kind of hit it on the bike, and then the running is my strong suit. So if I can finish it all, you know, at least set myself up to finish it all,
yeah,
I should be good. But I'm not trying to kid myself, you know, win any records or anything like that. Finishing is like the biggest thing, but I want to finish in a decent time.
So, think back to a little bit of music, like what music do you, what's music, what music do you work out to?
That's the tough part is when you actually do the race, you're not allowed, you can't have any music at all, so that's like, you know, 6 hours ish, no music, and I'm used to using music all the time. I mean, obviously not in the pool, but you know, on the bike, you know, hammering an hour and a half or 2 hours on the bike, when you at least got to use the reference, you won't have any of that. So it's kind of more chill stuff, like when I'm running a 10K, I can't be listening to Lamb of God, I can't be going metallic or anything like that. I have to like listen to really, really laid back stuff. Because otherwise it just affects my adrenaline. So yeah, it's usually really mellow stuff. I mean, usually rock stuff, but mellow stuff. Yeah, I've got some playlists that are like, you know, just a lot of female singers, a lot of folk music, you know, just stuff that you wouldn't normally think that I'd be listening to. You know, when I'm lifting weights, that's when I got behind the guy, the talent.
Yeah.
But for the run, I gotta relax.
So, you guys have a new album out, All I See Is War, and we've seen a couple of times that it's not a political statement, the title, and I know it's kind of taken as that initially.
Sure.
What is the kind of statement that...
You know, it could be political. It's kind of just an observation of, I think, the world around us. You know, if you follow politics and you see what's going on with that, it's one thing, but you don't even really have to do that. It could be just as simple as, you know, something happens, the media runs with it, and then all of a sudden Facebook and Twitter, you just have these wars. Like, all your friends, you look through your friends list, and you've got people blocking each other and unfriending each other. And, like, legitimately, people that won't speak to each other, you know, for long periods of time, and it's like, I'm just trying to figure out where the, like, I remember we used to be able to have a conversation, you know, with politics, there used to be a middle ground where you could sit down and say, okay, I get it, you know, I don't live your life in your shoes, and you don't live in mine, but it's so depressing when you see friends of yours on social media that are just really, really buying into this stuff, and they're letting it affect our lives, so for us, we just looked around and was like, wow, you know, put Facebook down, turn the TV off, make some music, and it was like, all I see is war kept coming up. And it was kind of one of those things where we didn't realize it until later into the album because we had used the war thing and probably seven of the songs on the record. Like half the record was referencing that a lot. So we noticed that common thread and it kind of made it itself. It's kind of obvious in that. But it wasn't one of those ones that came quickly. Black Out the Sun came pretty quickly. Cold Day Memory came quickly. You know, certain album titles come. We were finished mixing. We had already started our artwork. We were like, what are we going to call this thing? And it just kept coming back to All I See Is War. That was the same thing, the same vibe. That's what it needs to be.
So the first single, Dirty, gets a lot of play, especially up in the Cleveland area. It seemed like you guys came out like throwing the first punch at that song. Like, you didn't choose like a middle of the ground. It was like straight forward, which I think is awesome, actually. But what's the meaning behind that song? Why did you guys choose to push that one out?
That one's just kind of like, I think it really builds kind of a theme for the whole thing. It's like, you know, it speaks about the war issues, it speaks about the, you know, the knockdown dragouts that you can have with family members on that. You know, at the end of the day, we're completely cool with who we are and who we believe in, and, you know, we can die knowing that we're good. You know, you don't have to convince me of your point of view, and you don't have to, you know, we can agree to disagree and be totally cool with it. But for that song, coming out with that one first, it was, we fought it a little bit only because I was like, I don't know, it's pretty heavy. It's like, it's a different vibe for us. It kind of had a newer kind of a, I don't know, just a sensibility that we haven't tapped into in a minute. And it was kind of an obvious one because there were some people talking about something a little more middle of the ground, like medicated or sickness, or you know, you kind of lay up a little bit. I was like,
start here.
There's something pretty cool.
Like your training, start here.
Kicking the door down, So yeah, you know, on Dirty, we just said, all right, well, you know, most of our fans and program directors that had heard it kept going back to that song too. Like, you got to do that for the first time. Okay.
You're great. sound, and you talk about being different sound, it's like the sound of the ball, but yet every album is like distinctively like Sevendust, like you know it's Sevendust. What do you think that's a product of? Just your willingness to experiment your entire career with different sounds, and just kind of who you are as a, you know.
I think, I mean, in all honesty, I think we really lean on the power of what John brings to the band. I mean, he can sit down and he can sing the most beautiful, chilled acoustic, just him and one guitar line, or he can be up there with, you know, two heavy guitars, drums, bass, just stuff going off the chain. So there's a lot of different gears in between those two. And, you know, honestly, I think it's just a diversity that not a lot of bands have. You know, some bands you'll have the heavy guy, and some bands you'll have the mellow guy, and some bands you'll have the heavy and the mellow guy. But somehow or another, we've figured out to kind of tuck in behind him, because whatever he can't do, let him go in there and do the heavy stuff. Morgan will do the real high screaming stuff. You know, Vinny sings, I sing, and everyone's got a, you know, it's almost like the heavy metal Eagles at any one time. You never know who's going to be singing what. But I think that's the thing, is it's like we've challenged ourselves melodically, you know, vocally, lyrically, and the music kind of goes hand in hand. You know, we're influenced by our surroundings. So we hear a lot of people doing more progressive stuff. Sometimes we kind of tap into that, you know. When we started, we were just like, you know, the version was like 10 almost one, like not quite the one. And then each record, you kind of build on your base of what's possible. You know, you try different things. Some things you try and you're like, all right, that's a little too weird for us. Most of the really weird ones for us are the ones that are more, and this is going to sound crazy, but the stuff that's more like geared towards radio, not that we sit down and go, okay, we're going to write a radio song, but yeah. We've tried so many of those songs, like Unraveling, and they just don't translate. It's not that they're not good songs, just for whatever reason, Sevendust, people who react to Sevendust want heavier stuff, or mellower stuff that's not radio-oriented for some weird reason. So we just kind of go with, hey man, we're not picking any singles anymore. You guys pick the songs, and it's all on you.
That's like the way to go about it, though. And you can't take any blame either. Like, oh,
that's
your
what I'm
fault.
Saying. Like, it's your fault.
So there are a lot of bands that list you guys as an influence, up-and-coming bands. Are there any up-and-coming bands that you've seen that you kind of would take notice of or that influence you?
I mean, I kind of draw influences from everywhere. I don't know necessarily up and coming, but the stuff that I've been listening to lately, which would probably surprise a lot of people, really, really, really loving the new Ask and Alexander record. Believe it or not, we toured with those guys a couple of years ago, and they've taken a step more in this commercial realm that I think suits them really well. I mean, I love them when they do the super heavy stuff, but that new record, it's just one of those records that's a record that I'll listen to when I go out on a run. If I'm going to go out for a long run, I just want to focus on one thing, you know, working on whatever, that's one of the records that'll do it. But I mean, there's so many cool bands that we draw influences from. Noah Gunderson is a singer-songwriter. I believe he did the Sons of Anarchy music. He's got some solo music that is nothing short of amazing, but it's super, super chill. Like I said, you know, it really depends on what the focus is, you know. If I'm making new music for the Sevendust record, it's, you know, Vulgar Display of Power, and, you know, the first three Metallica records, I mean, that's kind of the headspace I try to, like, get into. Because I know that the rest of the stuff's all going to fall into place, but, yeah, I mean, as far as new artists, like, there's so many cool bands out there, but to me, it's just, I don't really listen to a lot of current radio. I listen to a lot of stuff that, sometimes I'll put on Apple Music and we'll listen to playlists. I do that with LJ a lot. But most of the stuff they play on there is stuff that's been around for a minute. You know, I mean, it's pretty diverse, but you know, everything from, you know, Nothing More all the way through on to us. You know, we've been around for 20 some odd years. So, but yeah, I mean, we kind of try to keep up with everything that's kind of happening right now. We try to at least acknowledge it. And even if we're not into it, if you're out here and you're slugging it out, I have respect for you. Might not be my cup of tea, but hey, man, you're out here.
So 20 plus years you've been together, all the albums, the Grammy nominations, what's left that you really want to achieve? Are you just kind of like, this is all wonderful? And I can die happy.
You know, it's like, I don't know. I mean, I guess I'd be lying to say that, you know, in the back of your mind, we got really, really close to the Grammy, but we didn't get it.
Yeah.
You know, and that's, I mean, my favorite band on earth is Pantera, and they never got a Grammy either, so I'm like, okay, it took Megadeth 12 times before they got theirs, you know. So, I mean, it would have been cool. It's not really that big a deal, but I can tell you one thing, it's a huge deal for our families, like our moms and dads, and, you know, people who, it's just, it's easier in a conversation when they're sitting down with their friend who has no idea what's going on. You can say, my son was nominated for a Grammy. Oh, they know what that
is. Plus, they made so many sacrifices on the road to see,
they can talk to their friends and talk about, you know, Grammys the way that actors talk about Oscars or things like that. So I get the why it's important.
Yeah.
For us, I mean, I think just being acknowledged by, you know, the Academy, which is pretty cool, because the one unique thing about the Grammys is it's all in-house. And all the voting is done by, you know, producers, you know, people who are in on this side of the fence, in the business, you know, working in the business. So it's not as much of a popularity thing as it is just acknowledging someone for being around a minute. So it felt kind of cool. It's like, all right, we're getting ready to be together for 20 years, and they finally said, hey, we realize you're here. You know, so for us, it was like,
and what a great song to choose to do. Such a nice thing to write for, you know, the band.
It was cool. It was a last song on the record. It was kind of a throwaway song. It was a song that was not going to make the record by any stretch of the imagination. And we fixed it, and then we got Kiss to sing on it, and then everyone went, that's your first single. I was like, of course it is. That's the way it works. And so anything we're getting ready to trash, that's it.
That's the
Thank you for sitting down with us and working with us your day here. You get a tattoo if you want to. Sure. Check out the prison, whatever else is going on here.
A little freak show over there.
Yeah,
so there's a lot to do.
Got some
going on. Yeah, thank you so much.
Absolutely.